wonder was, what was this mystery coaster? Well, all I could do was phone up my very good friend Harold Hudson at Six Flags. And I said, "Harold, what's this thing you're building?" And he said, "I can't tell you." So I said, "Look, we're not in competition with you. We're thousands of miles away from you. Could you possibly do us a favor and share some information? Because it could be just what we want." So he said, "Come over and I'll tell you." So I went over to Texas, where Harold operated from. He worked out of Six Flags over Texas. And he said, we're working with B&M to actually turn a stand-up coaster upside down. In other words, have the coaster beneath the track. So I said, "Well, we got one of those. We got one at Chessington, it's a swing coaster." Oh, but he said, "This thing isn't going to swing. It's actually going to go through loops." And I said, "Well, that's impossible. You know, you can't turn an inverted coaster through loops and corkscrews and barrel rolls and things." And he said, "Well, this is not going to swing. The car is going to be rigid to the track. And B&M are that convinced that they can accurately bend the track so that they can actually turn an inverted coaster upside down. So we agreed that provided we said absolutely nothing to anybody else in the industry, we would be party to all the information that Six Flags were developing. Providing in return, we would scratch their backs if they ever wanted any help, which we've subsequently been able to do. So we visited B&M and we talked about the ride. They came, they had a look at the site, and they said, "Yes, we think we can make it work." Then we went over to Chicago, and we rode the Superman ride at Chicago. We were it had been running for about a week with sandbags, but we actually got to be one of the first people to ride that ride in Chicago. We then came up with a layout for Nemesis. Of course, it wasn't called Nemesis. Now, this is the original CAD drawing, and for those of you that are a bit savvy, anyone know what that is?
Thunder Looper.
Yeah. The Thunder Looper was still in existence. This is the monorail. And now what I'll do is highlight the Nemesis track a bit so that you can see a bit clearer what's happening. Here is the station. Nemesis, I suppose you won't have seen Nemesis in CAD before. It's not the sort of thing that I'm so familiar with it. But that's basically what Nemesis looks like in CAD. Here's the station. This is the lift going up to the trees. We've got the first barrel roll round the tight bend, up over the station with the inline twist, down into the bottom of the hole, vertical loop, round, through the final barrel roll and into the station. Now, B&M were not going to put that barrel roll in. They had the thing simply coming around, going up over the track there, round the bend and back into the station. And I said, I wanted our ride to end up with a sensational inversion. And also an inversion that is at the same eye level as the people who are standing watching. You see, most of you in this room today have no fear of roller coasters. You love riding them. We all love riding them. You have to remember that there are a lot of people out there that are terrified of them. And I want more and more people to enjoy riding roller coasters. And the way to do that is not to frighten off people. The whole idea of the layout of Nemesis was that you could enjoy it even if you didn't ride it. You could get in and amongst it. Roller coasters traditionally have been put behind a barbed wire fence, and either you go on the ride or you stay out. I wanted Nemesis to be enjoyed by everybody, and I wanted the final barrel roll to be viewable from a walkway that was at eye level. Now, Anne Clegg here, when Ralph was doing his introduction, he didn't tell you actually that Anne was project champion on Colossus at Thorpe Park. So if you've got any questions on Colossus, Anne's the person to ask. Again, Colossus was conceived in terms of the pathways and the routing through it, so that even if you don't ride the ride, you can still enjoy it by having eye contact with the riders that are riding it. So that's the Nemesis layout. It involved blasting an awful lot of rock. The foundations for Nemesis were probably the most complicated roller coaster foundations that had ever been built, because there wasn't one single foundation that was at the same level as another. And we started work. But as you well know, Nemesis is an awful lot more, there's a lot more to it than just a load of steel and concrete. And we decided that we wanted to build up a whole brand. And this is where you want to talk to Gary and Tracy about the branding of Nemesis. We hadn't a clue what we were going to do with the thing. And this memo is from me, dated November the 5th, 1992. Subject, secret weapon. And it was this that got it all started. I'll just read it so that you can find the copy. Right. We all know that roller coaster hardware we're about to acquire will give us one of the most sensational roller coaster rides in the world. However, this hardware is available to anyone with sufficient cash, and we are therefore determined to conceive its theme so as to make it the most sensational in the world, and one which cannot be copied. For some time now we've been agreed that the ride would be themed as some huge alien creature. But in order for me to pull this together into a cogent form, Nick Varney and I, he was the then marketing director of Alton Towers, arranged a brainstorming session with our various PR, advertising and promotional agents and consultants. This proved to be a most useful exercise, and from this I have pieced together the scenario which follows. It must be appreciated that it is not necessary for the visitors to grasp the storyline. In fact, what they see must be an enigma to them, and therefore we don't want them to fully understand it. This is what we call a backstory, and that is what is on these videos that you've got in front of you. However, in order for us to design the station, the colour of the track and structure, the name of the ride, the music and its special effects, in other words, the theming, and this is what you want to talk to Paul Lanham about, because Paul is art director for the studios, who is responsible for all what we term theming. Don't like that word, none of us like that word actually. It's vital for us to understand exactly what's going on. Please don't therefore get hung up about whether the following is too deep for the visitors to grasp. In this instance, that's a good thing. We want the visitors scratching their heads in disbelief. Right, well, this is the legend.